Ladies and gentlemen, you know what it is. It's real late. It's a Sunday night. It's New York City. My guy, it's been a very long time. Vincent Staples is here.
How you feeling, man? You good?
I'm good, man. I'm good. How you been? How's life been for Vince Staples? Pull that mic a little closer to your mouth, Paul.
Got you. That better?
Yeah, it's perfect.
Yeah, man, I'm good. Chilling, man, at the house, not doing too much of nothing.
You're out on the road with Tyler now.
Yeah, we're on the road right now on the Call Me If You Get Lost tour. Supporting his album is me, Tizo Touchdown, Kelly Uchis, and Tyler, obviously.
And before that, you were just in the crib.
Yeah, man, chilling, nothing too crazy.
I feel like the pandemic was almost like built for you. Like you're built for stay home life.
Yeah, it's all good. I was doing that regardless, you know, just kind of staying insulated and, you know, enjoying life, things like that.
And I saw, you know, when they sent me like the folder of, I mean, the email, email.
Yeah.
And in the prep email is, let's see, it includes 10.2 million TikTok views weekly. So I'm not a TikToker.
I don't even have a TikTok.
Wait, what do you mean?
I don't have a TikTok.
So how are you getting 10 million views weekly?
I don't know, man. They probably hashtagging and stuff like that.
You mean like all the random shit that you've said that like people love?
Yeah, probably, like, yeah.
Like the thing that you came on and said my show about Ray J that time?
Yeah, I see that every probably 2 months.
People love circulating.
Yeah, man, yeah.
The Ray J theory was, when you were talking, I just thought it was you being you, which is you have random theories in general, which always have truth to them. That's what makes them brilliant.
Yeah.
But that one has been like a thing.
Yeah, it's kind of annoying. Like, only because it's like, man, all the shit we talk about.
That's the one. The Richard theory.
Yeah.
All right. So there's a lot of stuff I want to get into, but I guess I'd be, I don't know, a comfortable way to bring it up because it's not super fun. But the last time I saw you was at Malcolm's funeral.
Yeah.
That was definitely the last time I saw you, and we had like a lot of real conversation there, and I knew it wasn't the time at that point to kind of talk about your relationship because you guys were so close. But I thought it would be cool if you were down to share it. You told me that day, like, just how responsible Mac was for your beginnings and how he basically refused to let you not rap.
Well, yeah, it's like, and my thing is, I wouldn't even say it was the beginning, because just to kind of respect the people that helped me before.
Right.
But it was a turning point that was important. He gave advice, but also opportunity. I would say is the easiest way to put it. Like, it's like, okay, you should be doing more music, but I'm also going to help you with the beats, and I'm not going to charge you, and I'm going to take you on tour, and I'm going to kind of help you figure out how tour goes, and I'm going to make sure that you don't have any expenses on tour. And it kind of just put me in a good position to be set up, you know what I'm saying? Because, you know, it's always good to be like, you should do this, you should do that, and like, oh, how do you make music? How do you become successful? You tour, you sell merchandise, you do this, you do that, but just giving me a spot on that tour before I was really deserving of it. You know, he had acts himself, and of course he did have his acts on that tour. I'm not saying he didn't, but for me to be there on that whole tour and, you know, be able to be there, you know, playing right when the doors open, you know, in front of the internet's band set up and things of that nature, like, you can tell that I was really squeezed into it. You know, I always appreciated that, you know, him, and then, you know, him giving me a relationship with Q and Schoolboy Q really helping me learn how to.
He was the connector. He was the connector between you and school.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I met him at his house. I never met him before, and and then me ended up going on the tour for Q's Oxymoron album, and just Q, you know, helped me learn about tempos and things of that nature. All of that comes from Mac. Like, I met a lot of people at Mac's house. I met, you know, Soul at Mac's house. I met Thundercat at Mac's house. It's honestly too many people to name because everyone was always over there. But you know, it was his studio was a very It was a very interesting place in the sense of who you can run into, and like just the relationship that he had with other people made it a really good environment. Like, I done seen Future at Mac's house, you know what I mean?
Really?
Like, yeah, it's crazy.
That's a crazy one.
Yeah, man.
So you the way you told it to me when I saw you, that I loved it. It was super interesting. But you were like, basically everything you told, every reason you gave Mac as to why you couldn't do something.
Oh yeah, he fixed. He used to pick me up.
Like, he was like, you were like, I don't have a ride. He was like, well, I'll drive you.
Yeah, exactly. Like, it was like, it was just, you know, it was like I said, he also gave opportunity with the advice. Like, it was like, you know, people wasn't coming to where I lived at to come pick me up, not for any reason except for just being really far from the part that I live in.
Yeah. You know, he was in Studio City, right?
Yeah, he was
and
in
Long
Studio
Beach
City.
Is, how far is
this
that?
This the thing, I wasn't even in Long Beach. I was at my grandma's on Watts. I was on 89th and Hooper, which is like, it's probably easier to get to Long Beach because you just stay on the 405. It's like, it's just really out of the way.
Right.
So it's like, you know, just him being there and coming to pick me up from my grandma's house, like, you know what I mean? Just like, it was very, you know, he didn't have to do that. You know, I will always appreciate it. I talked to his mom the other day. I talked to his mom a lot.
And how did you guys, like, then you guys ended up making, like, there was, like, a lot of viral content of you guys, too, just being,
you know, it's crazy.
A-holes.
I didn't know that that was a thing because I wasn't on the internet like that back then. I just now knew that. Literally, when I say just now, I mean probably, like, 2 years ago, found out that all that was on the internet.
Yeah, because I don't know what it was for. I forget what website it was even for, but there's a bunch of content of y'all just messing around.
Yeah, he had a Vine that he was really active on at the time, and then he had his MTV show that he was active. I didn't have no cable, so I didn't watch it, but I didn't even like really think about it. But I remember filming the show, but it's like, you know, a lot of that stuff has been resurfacing, especially after he passed. And yeah, man, like, he always had that phone in his hand. Like, he was very direct to consumer with the way that he kind of dealt with his fans. I think that comes from his history of independence and just kind of being direct with his fans and just them knowing his life. You can hear it in the music too. And for people who don't know anything about Mac Miller, like, if you look at how his fans, you know, hold him in that kind of regard, it was a very personal experience.
Was it weird for you? Like, you've talked a lot about your past growing up and the crazy things that Vince Staples has seen, mm-hmm. is part of the Vince Staples persona, in my opinion. Mm-hmm. Was Mac's death weird because, like, you've gotten accustomed to seeing death, but Mac, did it feel random? Like, I don't know if the word's misplaced. Like,
I know what you mean.
It wasn't street. It wasn't a street death. It was someone overdosing.
Yeah, well, like, I had a homie who passed, who overdosed not that long ago, like, not too far before him. I had a homie that overdosed right after North North came out. His heart exploded, actually, pills and shit. But it wasn't. Mac was going through a lot, and my thing with him is, like, he was trying to get better. That's all that mattered to me. You know what I mean? It's like, oh, it was unfortunate because it's like, oh, he was kind of getting into a good place, and, you know, it's ups and downs with addiction and, just, you know whatever else he was dealing with. You know, which isn't for me to say. That's for him to say.
Yep.
But I just know he was trying. So that was like it kind of what it did to, like, you know, the people around him was the saddest part, because, you know, if, you know, people believe in a better place after this and all this other shit, that can give you, you know, solace for the person that's passed. But, you know, you kind of saw how much he held together with him being around.
Yeah.
And what it did to the people around him, like, was like the saddest part for me. But, you know, as long as he was trying, you know, we can't be here forever. But it was kind of random, but kind of not. And the reason it wasn't, because I knew him personally. So, you know, kind of the things that he dealt with and struggled with, but he was trying really, really hard to, you know, get better and stuff like that. So that's all I can really hang my hat on.
Now, rest in peace to Mac. Now, you dropped an album. The Vince Staples project was a year ago? Year and change?
No, like
2 years ago?
8 months.
Yeah,
yeah, like 8-9 months.
I think
so. It had to, because it was towards the end of last year.
Yeah.
Before the holidays.
The song that I was the my favorite joint on here, actually, it's the first song, man. Like, I like the whole project. Mm-hmm. It's a really solid project. But if y'all haven't listened to this song right here, the way it starts.
Yeah. 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 City going up, so you better bust. Finna see what really wanted us, really spilling blood. Everybody tough, till they gotta go and see the judge. Nigga better hush. Remember growing up, all I wanted was to be a thug. Wanted me a plug to get a little bread. Shoot a couple niggas in the head.
So I guess the question is, why, when I want to listen to this song that I love so much, do I have to just look at a close-up picture of your face on my Spotify?
Contrast, man. Contrast. I think contrast is important. It's important to kind of give a roundabout identity, you know, for people that don't. You grew up in a different time, I grew up in a different time where those kind of things mattered. Like, now I understand why it's different, but it's like, yeah, man, like the contrast of the sonics and the stories, and just kind of, it speaks to, you know, a lot of things I do are hyper focused. It speaks to, like, the reality of California, the reality of a place, like the places in which I grew up, the place that, you know, the world knows about, obviously. And it's like, you know, it's both. It's both bright and dark. It's both beautiful and, you know what I mean? You know,
well, tell me about this then. Tell me about this part. Mm-hmm. This interlude right here to me is the most you-ish thing on her.
Nigga met this nigga at the McDonald's at Lakeville Mall. This nigga like randomly like, bro, I got the blue LX for your 38 Derringer. Mind you, nigga, this a, you feel me? It's a little pearl handle thing. In and out. Nigga, give it to him. Later on that night, nigga get pulled over. Police thoroughly searched the car. Oh God, nigga would've got cracked if I would've kept it. And they never even knew I got rid of the gun. I never told them. So the whole time they searching, everybody in the car is scared. I forgot to tell them, like, nigga, Ben gave that shit away. Damn, niggas go to this little party. Whatever the case, niggas like, fuck it, we ain't got nothing to do. We gon' go. Mind you, niggas ain't had shit to do all day. Niggas been getting robbed and some bullshit. This is wild. Then it's like, nah, I'm cool. Niggas go shake, go home. Later on that night, the homie, they get booked. Two bodies, crazy. Allegedly though, free tie, but moral of this whole story, nigga gotta think ahead, which a nigga always have. You gotta separate yourself from bullshit. Can't get wrapped up in it. And once again, it's their free pack slam to their free pack slam.
Yo, that shit is so hard.
Yeah, I appreciate it, man. That's one of my best friends. That's homie Tyson Smith. He doing a lot of time right now. And it's funny, like, he got arrested a minute ago, and I was in Atlanta. I had to go to Atlanta, kind of try to stay out of some trouble, some stuff I had to wait on to cool down. And when I came back, I started making music. I wasn't around that much because it was still kind of, like, tricky, you know? And one of my homies, I told him, like, yeah, man, you know, Vincent rapping. I was like, what? Like, that's weird because I'm not, as you know, I'm not, like, an outgoing type person, things like that, but... And he's like, what it sound like Soulja Boy? We should like listen. We should listen to Soulja Boy. He's like, you know, fun type stuff.
Yeah.
And it's funny, like when I became successful, he was like, nah, you was always gonna be good. He's like, his favorite thing is like, he's like, you always knew when to go home, and you always knew when like it wasn't worth. He's like, you know, we've been lucky for a long time because you. And he always brought up that story about we was young, and he was like, man, we young, we teenagers. He was like, I bought a gun from him, and he was like, man, we got pulled up right then. If I'd have got caught with that, it'd be over. He's like, you got to kick it with me every day. Because they older than me. I'm like 12, 13 at this time. They like 17, 18. And like, you know, I just used to hang out with them a lot. I was way younger than them, way smaller than them. But it's like, I don't talk. You know, when you young, you around, like, you cool. Ain't nobody going to mess with you. Like, you know, so I always like would be like, hey, man, you sure we should do that? Like, we can do it. But like, I think we should wait till tomorrow. Or like, oh, I don't think we need to go to the fifth party tonight. And I was always able to escape things. He'll always be like, man, you know, just trust your judgment because you've always had, like, decent judgment. Like, you've always been lucky. And the other interlude on there kind of being my mother and talking about understanding just, you know, how to grow past certain things. Like, just a lot of depth in messaging that, you know, is important to me. Because I feel like, you know, Steven Spielberg once said, you know, Steven Spielberg said, I don't make movies for fans. I make things that I like, and hopefully a lot of people go see it, but I don't care about the people that. And you know, he got a lot of slack for saying that, but I kind of understand that. I use music to kind of figure myself out and figure life out, and you know, just try to put things in there I care about.
And do you care? Like, you're incredibly respected. There's kind of like two ways that people know you. So you're respected, and everyone knows you're a dope rapper and a dope artist, because like you have melodies and you do a lot of things besides rapping. But then there are some people who just know you for personality. They love a Vince Staples interview. They love a clip of you that moves around. Do you feel like you're on Tyler's tour? Tyler has managed to take this step into being like a very commercially viable artist, even though his music's not terribly commercially viable. How much do you care about, you know, the music being super popular versus just being able to do what you do?
Well, I'm appreciative of, like, you know, whatever level is digested at, you know, people die without getting here. You know, I mean, I was talking to Earl one day when we was younger, and I used to be like, bro, like the things you cared about when you was a kid, like Doom or Blue, or, you know, the people that you look up to, you're already bigger than they ever were. Merge, you're already bigger than they ever were. And we thought they were the top of the world. So we have no complaints, and we've already gotten there. So they'll try to, you know, alleviate stress and things like that. We're just talking amongst your friends. And that's not to diminish their contribution at all.
No, but the game has changed.
Yeah, that's to say how lucky we are.
Yeah.
So
there's money in doing good music now.
Yeah,
it didn't used to be there.
Exactly. So that's exactly what you're saying. So I look at it like I'm grateful regardless. But I look at it like we all know how much stuff goes into what it takes to be that. You know what I mean? Like Tyler has proven himself over and over again and built his own merchandising elements and built his own core fan base, because Tyler was operating mostly from core fan base and still selling a lot of albums, but that's because of the tangibility of his product. So when Tyler can sell you a CD or a vinyl or a t-shirt, blah, 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 it's going to kind of, so I still haven't figured that part out. So I know a lot more goes into that, plus label support and all these other things in branding. So if we get there, we get there. But, you know, if we do, I'm grateful. And if we don't, I'm grateful. And even when people are like, oh, you know, I don't really like his music. I like he, but he's cool. That doesn't bother me because, you know, I'm a person. You feel me? Like, what is music at the end of the day? Like, it's just a one way. That shit.
People, some people like certain music. Some people don't like certain. It is what it is.
Yeah. And I take so many risks and try to do so many different things. If I'm really making music for myself, how can I be upset that somebody else doesn't like it? I appreciate them even going to listen to it. You know, like I read recently somewhere 60,000 songs are uploaded on Spotify alone per day. So Jesus, if someone's listening to your music when it's that much option, I don't feel like you personally can complain.
And no, and if you go to, and if you were to go to Vince's page, like you've had some different records, some collaborations, and some things that have really moved around. You know, if you look at Vince's, let's see what you
have. Yeah, I got Billie Eilish songs. I have songs with the Gorillaz. I have songs with also Schoolboy Q. I got songs with Royce da 5'9".
Bro, you have songs with hundreds of millions of streams.
Yeah, and that's the thing. Like North North, even though I didn't have a big radio push or a big budget because I wasn't deserving of that at that time, so I had to prove myself as an artist. You know, North is platinum, and Clam's got a plaque. I don't buy those things. North North is platinum. I think Big Fish is gold. Earl's first album just went gold. The Billie Eilish song is gold. Flume song is gold in Australia. I've had
record, right?
Yeah, I've had some successes, and you know, being around some good people. So you know, I appreciate it, especially just doing whatever I want when I want to. No, I'm doing really, really well for like what I'm trying to do and how I play the game. Like I'm extremely grateful and proud.
All right, let's actually play that joint. Let's play your new joint with DJ Mustard.
Yeah, man. Shout out Mustard, man. Really, really good dude.
This joint right here, Magic, is a perfect. Was this your first record with him?
Yes, but it's the first one that came out.
Okay.
First one came out.
Because This is like, it felt like you see it and you're like, how is Vincent Mustard just now doing a song? Because you guys are perfect.
Well, that's my dog. Like he's such a good artist, and he's like, one thing about Mustard, he's very collaborative. Like when you go and see it with Mustard, we have two piano players, a guitar player, so you know he really has a love for music. We did a song, me and him, with Juice WRLD before he had passed. It just never ended up coming out. So We have worked before, and we did some stuff some years back. But you know, just he's just a good dude to be.
Is
around.
He is Mustard still very thin? Because he got.
Mustard, yeah, he's working out, bro. Like, he's getting fit. They play basketball every day. He ride his bike every day. He run every day.
Yo, shout out to my guy Mustard. I've never seen someone get thinner and put on tighter clothes faster than DJ Mustard.
Oh yeah, he dyed his hair. He was not playing. Yeah.
Like the second the weight came off, I saw him the next time. He was schmedium everything.
Yeah, he had to let him know he was putting that work in, man.
He did not mess around. All right, so the album in the notes here, and let's see in the big Vince notes here, you have an album that is coming sometime soon.
Yeah, it's gonna be around Coachella next month.
Ramona Park broke my heart.
Yeah, definitely. Ramona Park broke my heart. 16 songs, couple features, longest album I really ever did, besides Summertime 06 being like a double thing, but you already know that story behind that.
Yeah.
But I would probably say it's my completest thing to this day. You know, I feel like a lot of my work has been an anthology of my neighborhood, my past, and I think this is kind of the end of that for me. Like I'm not 18, I'm not 19, I'm not 20, I'm like 28 years old, you know. I've been blessed to live long enough.
You're 28 years old?
Mm-hmm.
God, you're still only 28 years old.
Yeah, that's what you get what I'm saying. Like, and I've been making music for 10 years, releasing it on like a major label, basically. I think Stolen Youth was probably 18, 19 years old. 19, 20 years old, so it's like, It's been a minute, man. Like I saw recently that Shine Coltrane Volume 2, I think yesterday, was the 8-year anniversary of it. My fans had posted it. Thank you to Liz and everybody who always keeps me, because they know I don't care about that stuff, so they remind me. But
wow.
Yeah, man. So I've been blessed to be here long enough to kind of.
So how old are you the day that Corey made me come out to Brooklyn and we met at Rubber Track Studios?
Ask him. I was probably 19, 18 or 19. I met Corey when I was 17. Yeah, so that was a long time ago, bro. Like, I didn't really have many songs, much music out, which thankfully the Mackie helped me. I think that was before the Mac project as well.
Yeah.
Yeah, bro. Like, it was.
That's a lot for 28 years old, bro. You've had a lot of, and that's only this part of your life.
Yeah, and I put out. You got to think. I put out you know, I've had a tumultuous label situation like that, not because of me, just because, you know, how the business works and streaming and things like that. I came out in a weird era. Like the day my debut album came out, Apple Music launched. So they stopped making, I think 1,500 CDs printed globally because they were banking on streaming, but it was not having an audience yet. It was like, I've dealt with certain things that we had to fight through. And it's like, yeah, man, like, I done put out 8 projects, you know, in that span of from 20 to now, I done put out 8 projects. So it's like being lucky enough to, you know, 5 albums and then the rest, the ones that don't count, you know, that type
but
of
still, stuff. But still, that's, and also one thing that you do that amazes me, you're very opinionated and you're vocal and everyone knows how smart you are and that you have interesting ideas, but you also don't get into like ish with people. How do you manage to be thought provoking and talk about culture? I'm trying to learn from you now, mm-hmm. without sort of stepping into bullish. Cause I think you do a good job not doing that, even though you let your opinions be known.
To be honest, as crazy as it might sound, I have to like credit that to like, you know, gang stuff. Cause it's like, you learn the necessity of certain issues. Like I got homies who like, I've seen how things go. Like I'm not walking around, just for example, I'm not walking around asking people where they from. Cause it's like, that can go left or right. Either way, it's like you're asking for a problem. And it's like, when I got into music, it's like, I'm not bringing up stuff that I know might have a negative impact. And also when it comes to people art, the way that I create, I understand, like, I've had people to be like, yo, man, just do this. Why you don't only make this kind of song? You can do, say for Magic, if for instance, like you can do this 10 times. I did a song on Queen and Slim, I'll Call Your Love on the soundtrack. And Ethiopia was like, yeah, man, we need more girl songs. Like, do you know how to make girl songs? Like, and not in a condescending way, but like
really
inquiring before she brought the opportunity. I'm like, I can make anything. And then I made that song and I got Black on it and all. And they were like, well, you've never done this before. I'm like, well, it's just, I don't feel like it's been that time. And even with this, with the album now, like, when I played it for them, they were kind of like shocked at the music. I'm like, well, it's just kind of where I am right now. But it's like, I understand that from a creative aspect. So I never want to talk about anybody's work. And also, I didn't grow up listening to a lot of music because of how music was in a transitionary point as far as like the assets of how you listen to music. Like, I grew up in the point of time between the CD and a LimeWire.
The re-download era, iPod. Napster.
Exactly. So I'm growing up in iPod era with no iPod of my own and 30-day free wireless internet from in front of the Stater Brothers in Paramount. So it's slow as shit dial-up. I don't, you know what I mean? So, and now we got one computer in the living room that's my mom's for work, so we can't touch it. You know what I mean? So it's like, I who am I to speak on what else somebody else creates and somebody likes it maybe. But also it's like, I try my hardest to not, I got to deal with so much negativity on my day-to-day life and like transitioning out of my environment I was once in that it kind of just made me be like, man, I don't want to say nothing bad about nobody because it's like, I don't ever want it to escalate. I don't want myself to be upset. And it's like, we all have opinions and I understand that, but my opinion is not worth maybe turning a dollar away from the next man. How you feel about, who's your favorite top five? Who's your favorite rapper? Who's somebody out of California? I'm either saying everybody or nobody. And it's because we're dealing with commerce. Mm. You get what I'm saying? Like you think about, you know, I study a lot of stuff about business and stuff like that. So it's like, when you think about businesses and like fast food for once, like a really big, it's a very American thing in American industry. Mm-hmm. And you'll always have outliers. So it was recently a new thing, like, you know, 90s, early 2000s, like, you know, the Pepsi Challenge, like things of that nature, like competitive marketing. Mm-hmm. But this competitive marketing is based on market share and marketplace. In music, we don't necessarily have that. We all fighting for the same spot in the hip hop rap inside of FYE, and now we all fighting for the same Rap Caviar playlist. So it's like, it's really no space for me personally to be like, this is better. This isn't. When Firehouse Subs came out, they had a distinct thing that would keep them. They were trying to be separate. We're all trying to be the same thing because of how we have to sell this thing. You know what I mean? People look at Jack Harlow and they look at NBA YoungBoy and they look at YB and Cordae and look at all these other people. Excuse me, Cordae, I apologize. They're looking at all these people doing this thing and they're expecting them all to be the same. People say, I love XYZ, so this other thing is trash. And I think it's counterproductive to what we do. And it's just based on how we've been like kind of trained as black people to treat each other, you know, due to slavery and things that have been deeply rooted. And it's like, we're all separate. I'm better than you. You're in the house. I'm outside. I'm in the house. You're outside. I work here. It's like that kind of, you live here. We live here. It's like, it's institutionalized. So it's a part of our culture in hip hop. And I just don't want to be a part of it. I spent my whole life not getting along with people for no reason. So I don't want to do that in my job.
That makes a lot of sense. I mean, even honestly, just from the first thing you said about, you know, living the life you lived has taught you to not even go up to someone and say, hey, where are you from? Mm-hmm. Like someone would hear that from my background and not even understand what you're saying. But they'd be like, why would you not say? And for me, not having that built into me mm-hmm. gets me in trouble. I end up getting myself in things because I say things mm-hmm. that white people fight really loosely when we fight. Like things get said.
Yeah.
Black people's line of fighting words mm-hmm. is different than that of white people very often.
Yeah.
And I sometimes culturally step into places where I say something that I'm like, I'm just talking trash. Mm-hmm. But you have no idea how you're affecting someone else who's from a different background than you are.
Well, yeah, and it's just really about explaining. And, you know, my thing is we gotta pick what it is, right? You got to see who's in this for the right reasons, who's in it together. Not just music, but just the relationships and as far as how you treat people and how you interact with people. And you can't be upset without being willing to educate. And it's one thing I learned because I always listen to other people. And it's like when somebody's mad, I'm not. If my homies, right, you know, you get into with your homies all the time. It's like gang shit. It's like macho machismo. Like my like, man, fuck that nigga. It's never with me. Like, well, fuck you too. I honestly be like, it's fun. Like, what's wrong? Like, what I do? And then I remember one of my homies, like, got mad at me one day. We playing 2K. And he's like, man, fuck this nigga. Blah, 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 blah. Mad, screaming. I'm laughing. I'm like, bro, what's wrong? And I was like, I'm finna leave. I tried to shake his hand because I was on the way out. Like, hours later, he's like, man, I'm not shaking your hand. I'm like, why? And he called me. He's like, hey, man, I'm not gonna lie, because he older than me. He was like, yeah, bro, like, you made me hot. But, like, he's like, you kind of fucked me up when you asked me, like, why? But my mom and, like, my household is kind of, like, stern. So it's like, and it's not strict, but it's stern, if you get what I'm saying. Mm-hmm. So it's like very tough skin. So I'm not going to be offended. And I think by me not being offended, I don't project. You know, we walk around. A lot of people have low self-esteem. A lot of people have their own fight. And a lot of times when people are successful, we hold it on our shoulder that we're successful because how hard you had to fight to be successful. So you look at somebody else who might not care as much as you or might not have done the things that you do, and you're telling them, you might be trying to teach them to be grateful. But it's coming out the wrong way. You might be trying to teach them to work harder. It might be coming out the wrong way. But we just have to know more about each other before we speak on each other.
Wow. You become a wise young man, Vince.
Hey, look, man, I just didn't used to talk a lot.
Although you've actually always been kind of wise. When you talk, you always kind of been a gem dropper. You've always been, I mean, I guess as you've always seemed older than your age, mm-hmm. even from when you were, you know, from when you were a kid. What do you like most want to do? You know, like you're around Tyler, you're on tour with Tyler. He's like the definition of someone who's kind of been like, I want to do this. I mean, the guy's got a
friend, yeah.
The guy's got a cologne. He's got clothing. I mean, he's selling his ridiculous expensive trunks. All anything he's interested in, he's turned it into his thing. So that must be inspiring. What do you like? What do you think you most want to do? Obviously, people think of you. They think of writing. I think TV, film, all those things.
One thing they used to, I didn't understand, and it's funny, you were there one day. I didn't understand. I think it was Ebro and also Charlamagne said two things on my first album run, and I wasn't upset about it, but it was like, oh, I wonder why they said that, because it was interesting that they both said it, and I know that they didn't conspire.
definitely not.
Exactly. I think Charlamagne said Vince Staples is way bigger than music or more important than music or something like that. Mm-hmm. And Ebro said, once he stops making music and does something else, he's going to be
out of here, whatever.
Yeah. So, and I was like, oh, I wonder why they said that. Me being young, I didn't understand opportunity. But as I get older and just to interview things and I think understand, you know, being able to explain certain things from my vantage point, things like that, I feel like, you know, I know that I'm not going to be the music guy. And I've never been upset about that. I've always done what I had to do because I was accessed. But just trying to figure out how to do other things and how to kind of get my voice across. You know what I mean? Like, that's kind of what I'm thinking about now and next. And just being I'm not a rapper. Like, of course I am a rapper and I appreciate it, but I'm not naturally someone who grew up my whole life wanting to be a rapper. I don't know as much as Tyler knows about music, Earl Sweatshirt, Mac Miller. Like, I've been around people.
You've been around greats.
Schoolboy Q. Exactly. So I've been around these people, so I know that I'm not them because I admire the knowledge that they have as far as the history of it. So I can't be short-sighted with it and be like, you know, I always had this relationship with music because I haven't graduated from high school. If I have a record, it's certain thing that I recently got clear, and I'm very proud of that. This was my only opportunity to do anything and be anything in life based on the hand I was dealt. So I always appreciate it in that regard. But now that I'm older, it's like, okay, it's going to be something else. And the world has always told me it's going to be something
That's
else.
That's interesting. Because, but you're, I'm not just saying it, but you're great at music. It's not like that. I hope you don't take it when people say that as they don't think your music's great.
No, not at all. Not at all. And that's what it's funny, especially Ebro specifically.
Because I know he thinks you're great.
That's what I'm saying. Ebro, but Ebro is like, I think it has more to do with the way that I approach things and like the kind of person. Like music is very, there's binds on what a song are.
Yep.
And
especially if you want to be popular, make you money or whatever.
And my thing about music is, we have to understand, of course, there are creative mediums like that, but music is made based on making people have a good time. And that's just based on my relationship with music from the stuff my mother, you know, my mother was born in 1957, not to give you a shit up, mama, but it's like my mom is older. So it's like when we growing up, my mom listening to Cameo and, you know, George Clinton and things of that nature, all that stuff was to have a good time. So a big part of music is people enjoying themselves. And it's like, so I do understand the commercialization of it. Music is entertainment even before it's art. So the way in which I'm trying to entertain people isn't best conveyed in modern day hip hop. And I think that's just what they're trying to say. It's not about me. It's just more about the thing that I'm trying to put myself in when there are things that I'm a perfect fit for.
So is it like, obviously I would imagine broadcast / podcasting has to have crossed your mind before.
Yeah.
Does it feel like now to do that? Does it feel too much like everyone has a podcast and that wouldn't be fun?
Well, this is my thing, right? When I think about podcasting and things of that nature, I think about social media. It's all social media. So it's like when you think about Instagram, it's doing the same thing. But what we do is a lot of the times hip hop is about being youthful and cool and what's next. So I look at it like this. People look at, oh man, that's you gonna wash yourself out or burn yourself out or this or that. But at the end of the day, we're doing the same thing for free that we can be doing for money. And it also makes it direct to consumer with the fan base. Because what the fan base does is I can speak to you directly via podcast rather than going and doing a magazine thing that no one's gonna necessarily read because it's too long-winded to be on your phone and print's almost dead. So you just have to be understanding of the world around you and the shifts of it. So podcasts, I recently learned how to start writing television scripts because I just trying to go through the Vince Staples show and just things being wrong, I just sat down and learned how to use Final Draft and all those other things and just, you know, kind of broadening out my stuff. Like I always came up with my video ideas if I could. I always, like the Vince Staples thing that we did, the show thing we did was all improvised and storyboarded by me and Calmatic. So I was like, okay, what would happen if I really sat there and thought about it?
And tried to really...
Yeah, growing and like, but my thing is, I look at Will Smith and I study Will Smith a lot because Will Smith was at the height of his career and said, let me go do something else.
Yep.
And it wasn't like he was an average rapper. Like when I was a little kid and you think about what a rapper is, because like I said, I didn't know a lot about music. You think Will Smith, Queen Latifah, LL Cool J, Snoop Dogg, you think people, Ice Cube, people that have transcended and done so many other things.
Yep.
And that is what music is. That is hip hop music is being larger in life. So I'm very open to doing it.
What's your favorite thing that you've done so far? Like if you were to say what you're most proud of in your career, is it an album? Is it the Vince Staples show? Is it a project, a video you did? Like, what do you think is the thing you hang your hat on the most? You go, you know what? That was pretty damn good.
I think probably, to be honest, and it's going to sound weird, but like learning to perform, because that was me not being, even being able to interview stuff. I don't talk a lot. I'm not animated. Like that's something that
I saw you on your first tour. I was at the first Schoolboy Q show.
So, you know, bro, it was horrible. And so it's like learning how to do that. It took a lot of hard work. It took a lot of like, that's something I can never, like, I'm not talking in class. Like I'm not going to school then. You know what I mean? So it's I was always that kind of person. So, I think learning how to perform and being able to, we headlined a festival in Australia, one of the stages at a festival in Australia. We've been to Fuji Rock. I've seen the world learning
how to. You're on Coachella this year, by the way.
Yeah, third one. Like, that's a lot of people don't get that many opportunities. And that's because I learned how to perform for not for just my fans, though, for whoever's in front of me. And I think I'm the most proud of that because that was the hardest thing for me to probably do.
So, what's your approach like? Like, I'm going to come check you tonight, but like, when you come out there, you're the first on stage tonight?
I'm second.
Okay, who's first?
Tizo Touchdown. Then it's me, then it's Callie, then Tyler.
Okay. So when you come out, It's still pretty early. People are definitely still finding their seats. And this is an arena tour. So tonight's Madison Square Garden. I've always found these moments to be kind of thrilling for artists because it's both exciting. And then when you're on stage, it's hard because you don't, you have your fans' attention. You got a few thousand who are there, like they know Vince Staples. But then you got the broader crowd that doesn't know you and you got to fight for them. So what's your approach like to these
shows? If you got 5,000, 10,000 even, that don't mean shit in Madison Square Garden.
Right.
But you have to realize it's not about you. It's about the show and it's about their enjoyment. We change our set all the time. Put this here, this is too long. Okay, you got a 45 minute set. Okay, it's too long for the fans. It needs to be around 40 minutes because you don't want to want them to feel bored, don't feel redundant. We're not talking to them much. Make the stage smaller, make the stage bigger. We've had to perform without our stage. Like at Madison Square Garden, we have half of our setup because of the sizing, but it's not about us. It's about their enjoyment. And it's about making sure Tyler has the best show he can have.
Right. Knowing that your job is you are opening for Tyler.
So if I'm opening up for Tyler, do I really want the fans screaming and jumping around? If I know Callie's coming on after me, okay, where are my more down-tempo songs? What lighting package does Callie have? If her show is bright, it's my job to make sure my show is darker in the middle. I can't go luminescent if I'm doing before her because then that ruins the excitement of her show. It ruins the excitement of Tyler's show. How do you work in like kind of concurrence with everyone else and kind of do your job on the road? And that's something that really I've opened up for a lot of people. I've opened up more than I've done my own tours. And the reason I've been able to open up for Gorillaz and Disclosure and Joey Badass and Schoolboy Q and Mac Miller and Donald Glover and Tyler a couple times, Rocky, I've been able to open up for all these people because I understand what my job is supposed to be.
Well, it's incredibly admirable too, because like, you know, I work in the wrestling business too, and like there are obviously people will have their match on third. And if they think that they're the main event and they do something that's supposed to happen in the main event, it's like, bro, people paid money to get here for the main event. They're waiting to see Roman Reigns or John Cena, whoever it is. It's great that you're on the show, but your job is to help make that better. And it's hard. It's an ego business. All of us get into entertainment in some way because we do want to perform, et cetera. So the knowledge of your knowledge of that brings peace. It allows you to get the most out of it for not only them, but for you as well. I wanted, before you go, I'd be remiss if I didn't ask you, even though it's dark, but yo, the violence in hip hop these days is crazy. The violence in the world is crazy.
Exactly.
The violence in hip hop has now it feels even crazier than it used to. The amount of big names or known commodities that we've lost has been really shocking, at least for me. And you know, like most recently because I was gonna say Draco, but since Draco passed, there have already been many more. The Draco thing's incredibly sad, obviously, and I just wonder, A, what your feelings are about what's happening. Is anything different? Is it just that we have more exposure and that people's barrier for entry into hip-hop is less? And just about the challenges of being a West Coast rapper who's from the streets trying to maintain without stepping in places that you really don't want to step.
So from a California standpoint, I could say that it's always been violence amongst gangs and it's always been these kind of things, so that's not new. Of course, more kids are trying to rap and make their way out because they have more accessibility. They don't have to go through a major label, they don't have to go through certain things, so Draco can pick up a microphone because he's a unique person. He can have a unique style of music, and Draco is able to make what he's making because you have dudes like Almighty Suspect and you have, you know, Earl Swavey, Who Kid, Joe Moses, G Perico, Nipsey Hussle, Schoolboy Q, Traffic, TF. It's so many people, too many to name. 211, Damani, Bad Luck. It's so many people over time that have made music. Music, even in Long Beach alone, going from D3 to Rockstar and TF Third to DW, Savvy Third. Going from I don't know his rap name, but
okay.
Lil Homie, man, Tiny Papa's, Kneezy, Vonnie. It's Joey Fat. So many people, you know what I mean? But the thing is, these kids are coming from the streets and they have the access to do it now, because I got a little homie who was just in YA and he was recording songs on his cell phone time and sending them to the homie to put on beats. But the truth of the matter when it comes to hip hop, in my opinion, is like, we got to stop pretending we care about these people and we care about these kids. This is a business. They want to use you and destroy you and get your money. And it's better for their business if you're dead. That's why they put out albums after you died. If they cared about you as an artist, they wouldn't do that. They would just give you a parent's remainder of your contract. They would give you health insurance. They would give you life insurance. It's just, you get what I'm saying? So it's like, we just got to stop pretending that these people care about us when they're running this business. You're going to see more death because you're going to see more authenticity in these stores and these streets. But we say over and over again, oh, it's not real. It's not this. It's not that. They soft, or they this, or they that. We push the gangster stuff over and over and over again. And then when people die, we don't tell the truth. We don't say why these people passed away. We never blame the streets. It's all they was hating, or it was a government conspiracy, blah, blah. It's not just you in the streets. And the reason they don't say that is because they want us to keep trying to be in the streets so they can keep marketing it. You know, what's a, you know, what's an action movie without an explosion? You know what I mean? What's a mafia movie without a hit? And this is their entertainment. Our lives are becoming their entertainment. And by they, I mean the people that aren't necessarily invested, the people that don't have to, that don't know the reality of it. And it's a very real thing. And the internet will say, like, you see artists beef, and it's like, oh man, go. And the second somebody dies, one person's stupid and one person's a murderer. Oh, I can't believe you hurt someone. But they listen to these songs over and over and over again. Just as an artist, man, know that it's a reason that this stuff is being pushed, and I fall for it. This is my life. Like, I tell people all the time, like, this is my life. Like, I don't like when people act like, oh, how do you feel about this is happening in the world? This happening in the world. We heard your music. Well, you didn't ask me about the 10, 15, 20 people I know that have passed since I've done music. And their names is in these songs. Like, I got, you know, I got homies in my videos that I was sitting next to that aren't here anymore.
Yep.
So it's like, so you don't ask me about that. So you don't care. And it's okay to not care, but we have to know that these people don't understand that this is reality, this is real, because we're so used to it being fake. When people say, oh, hip hop is entertainment, blah, blah, blah. For a lot of people, but not the kid who was growing up in this environment, and they were being told these stories about their environment, and now they feel like this is how they got to make it out. When I heard 50 Cent Get Rich or Die Trying, I was in the fourth grade, I was like, okay, the streets is okay. Because it's not. I used to be ashamed of my parents. Like, when I was a kid, I didn't tell nobody where I lived at. And it's like, y'all thinking about low self-esteem, stuff like that in children. So it's like, how do you convince yourself that it's okay to live in poverty, that it's okay to not have the best house? Okay, I lived in my aunt's back house on Oak Street in Compton. And when I went to Long Beach with my pops, I lived in the Boulevard Mafia's on, you know, 68th Street on a, like, damn near a one-way street. And it's like, oh, they can't come over here. It's bad over here because we hard. It's hard over here because we grimy. Like, you know what I mean? We used to say gypsy when we was kids. Like, oh, we gypsy. Like, that's why you can do that. That's why we'll rob our homies. We'll kill each other because this is our identity. But it's time for us to try to figure out how we can evolve our identity. But as long as it's not in our hands, it's never going to be able to evolve. You know what I'm saying?
Do you think that the, like, for example, I guess the part that perplexes me, and maybe this is just, maybe this is just the barrier to entry conversation. Mm-hmm. But, like, for example, because I question myself, mm-hmm. and I go, well, I used to love really gangster shit. Like obviously I love MOP. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? I love Fat Joe. I love every bit of, I love Cool G Rap. Loved NWA and Snoop Dogg and all of that. And it's not like bad, violent things weren't happening in the world then, but the artists themselves, I guess, It was maybe this is me trying to make myself feel better mm-hmm. about my interest as a white person who enjoyed that kind of music. But at the same time, it's easy for me to make myself feel better because I'm like, well, the artists that I was listening to, they were talking about violent things. But as far as I was aware of, the violent things weren't still happening to said artists. Yeah. And now at this point, what people are watching, and again, that doesn't actually make me better. That's just the time I happen to be there for. But right now, cats are watching these YouTube, you know, fights between people and YouTube feuds, they're real life beefs
well,
building.
Well, it's different. I feel like, from what I've been told, because I wasn't there, right? I feel like it was more protected. Like, when you hear Nori and all the other people talk about the role that their A&Rs and their executives they had in their life and moving them out and doing certain things for them, like when Snoop talks about Master P moving them to New Orleans, I don't think anyone's doing that anymore. I think they see the money in the violence.
It's the money's already there.
Back then, the violence ruined the money. So if I'm like NWA, right? In Eazy-E was like that. You know, Ren was a member. Ice Cube wasn't a violent dude. Neither was, and it's not, and that's not a slight.
No, they were artists. Trey was a DJ. Cube was a writer, an artist. Like,
but the thing is, I feel like people knew that. And then sooner or later, the marketing became, that's why Snoop was such a thing when he came out, because it's like, oh, this dude is,
she's real.
You get what I'm saying? And it becomes, not to say that that wasn't a thing before, but it's like, when I listen to Slick Rick, right? Anyone who knows anything about hip hop knows that Slick Rick's not like a pushover. Mm-mm. But he was still creating. He was trying to create art. He was telling stories, blah, blah. When I listened to Slick Rick as a kid, I couldn't have imagined that had the name that he had out here. Same thing when you think about like a KRS-One and BDP and dudes that was like in the streets. And they were able to transition Wu-Tang Clan, able to transition and try to do something creative. We have to push these kids and these people to push the envelope even more. You know, how do you show somebody that you done busy successful now? That you show them a real, you show them a stack of money, you show them a gun, and now you a real rapper. I don't feel like it used to be like that. I feel like Wu-Tang Clan, even though they might have been from Staten Island and all this other stuff, they still needed to show their uniqueness. They still needed to show stylistically who they were. I don't think that that's a thing anymore. Snoop Dogg was the gangster, right? You got to correct me if I'm wrong. Snoop Dogg came out and he was the gangster. Murder was the case, blah, blah, all this other stuff, right? Mm-hmm. But he was making party records.
Mm-hmm.
And if you look at what YG was, YG is a reputable who is who he says he is. But he's, bitch, who do you love? Even further before that, Tooted and Booted, like party records.
Yeah.
And I think that we just have to be, I feel like these kids don't feel like they have the ability to do that anymore. Now it's just got to be real.
They feel like the only thing that they can sell is these real life beefs. Like that is what the art is.
Look at the biggest things. The biggest things we have are those things.
Mm-hmm.
So I do understand it. And even when I look at my little homies, like I be trying to build music. I'm like, bro. No dissing, like, oh man, but blah blah, but it's like, but they're looking at it like they know me. You know how the neighborhood is. They know me, and they know the things I did when I was younger, when I was their age. So it don't sound right hearing me say that. I got homies that don't even listen to my music. They just know who I was when I was doing that. Mm-hmm. So they think that I'm more burnt out in my music than I actually is. People might, who is Vince Staples if you only know who he was on the streets and you heard North North,
right?
Then I'm just, or Big North North and Big Fish, the ones that got big, surprisingly.
Right.
You get what I'm saying? Who are you, Vincent, the dude that come to the hood all the time by himself and stand outside with us for, now they not looking at it like I'm not really a really famous person. People aren't driving down the street knowing who I am. So of course I'm gonna come kick it with the little homies. Of course I'm coming to your football game. Ain't nobody messing with me. And I don't carry myself in that way, but they looking at it like, oh, the homie bias. He's solo, and you see all these rappers on the internet with 30 people. The homie, a gangster. I'd had the little homie tell me once. Hey man, you really be tripping. I'm like, what do you mean? He's like, you know, he in prison right now. My little dude TJ, shout out TJ Manfred on me. He's like, I ain't never seen you without your shit, and I ain't never seen you by yourself. I was like, what does that mean? I was like, TJ, you don't know if I have a gun. You don't know if it's legal. You know if it's registered. You know, I was like, you don't know any of these things. You just assume. He's like, man, come on, bro. Like, come on. I'm like, bro, I don't. Nobody messes with me. He said, what happened if you see somebody? I was like, what's up, bro? How you doing? He's like, I remember with me and LaKim, one of my producers, LaKim Taylor, like, he produced other Queen Slim record. He produced a lot on this project as well. He told me when he produced a lot, he produced the Vince Staples Show songs as well. He was like, we went to a food truck. Fried chicken truck, SNCC by my homie Shag. Best chicken in LA. I got to put you on the gumbo. He's
please.
Real. He's amazing.
Okay.
We had his truck. You know, it's in the hood on the borderline. Dude walk up staring at me like mugging. Tattoos everywhere on his face, all that stuff. He walked by me like, what's up, bro? How you doing? He go, what's your name? Like, I'm like, my name Vince, bro. Everybody call me Little. He like, oh, hey, do me a favor, blood. Hey. Let me call my son, because he really fuck with you. And, you know, I was like, what he doing? Like, just talking to him about his son. Like, he ain't doing this. He ain't doing that. A little older than me. He ain't doing this. Blah, blah. We were like, man, like he said, oh, I got to tell my son. So, yeah, man, call him. Like, from like, yeah, FaceTime him. I'm talking to his son and yada, yada, yada. And he like, man, I fuck with you. Like, you cool. Like, whoop-de-whoop-de-whoop-de. But if you operate out of fear with that chip on your shoulder, it's because I feel like I'm going to get whatever I give. Whatever I put out in the world, if somebody come knock me down today, it's because of something I did in the past, and I got to live with that. But it's like, if I wasn't thinking positively, I might have been like, what's up with this dude? He trip, and I might have mugged him back. But he was really just looking at me like he here by him. Because the way we view rappers, he here by himself. I'm waiting outside for some chicken with one person, like, and then I see one of my other homies, from Dodge City, my boy Bo, and like He like, hey, bro, you remember me? I'm like, bro, you was my neighbor. How I'm going to forget you? Like, oh, you never know what niggas these days. So it's like
two situations in which you choosing to handle them differently could create completely different outcomes.
That's exactly what I'm saying. So I'm saying it's more based. Exactly. 100% right. I'm happy you said it. Thank you. It's like, help me around my thought. I was like, it's about how we carry ourselves and how we act. Because think about NBA players. We know they got hundreds of millions of dollars, but they don't have that specific target on their back. And these players is from the hood. DeMar DeRozan is from the hood. Russell Westbrook is from the hood. You know, Aaron Aflalo was from the hood. Baron Davis is from the hood. Ain't no taking that away from them. Nobody would even try to.
And they move around. They're out there.
Baron is
hungry. Baron's around.
I seen Baron Davis on Adams in L.A., drunk, having to meet with the H&M people in the hood, taking them to Alta Adams in these places. You know what I mean? But it's just we got to. I used to think about all the time, Chance the Rapper, we know he up, but it's just the way he carry himself. No one messes with him. So it's like, we just got to start treating each other with more love and respect as we can. I understand beef, I understand it's real out here, but, excuse me, we got to realize why this is the thing. Because it's money in it, and they're going to keep selling it, and we're going to keep perpetuating it, and then we're going to be hurt when somebody die. I don't necessarily know if they care. If they did, man, the album ready in 4 weeks once you die. And you get more press on the album you put out after you die. You get the radio budget, then you get the marketing budget.
Now we're used to it. Like, that's not even an uncommon thing. Like, listening to music posthumously in hip hop now is just like, there are multiple artists. There's a bunch of artists now who exist, who will exist so much more when they were dead than when they were alive. And not because they weren't great or didn't impact people, but just because of how quickly they passed.
Because when it comes to these systems, they look at you like, oh, you're dead. Now we have something to move with. And we got to realize as artists, it's not our fault. We got to stop blaming each other, and we got to stop treating each other like we the problem. We're operating in a system that has been like this since the 1950s when they was giving niggas Cadillacs for their whole catalog. Like, it's the same thing. Like, when you sign the music, you know, just for transparency for like people listening, when you sign a music contract, the contract says they have ownership, no matter how much percentage it is, to the extent of the known universe. Meaning that if they go build a colony on Mars tomorrow, they own your music. This is what we're fighting against. So, you know, just make sure we're respecting each other, appreciating each other. Because when you go to prison, you got to be with the dudes that's killing your homies.
Mm-hmm.
You get what I'm saying? Like, it is what it is. So this is music. We able to have a lot of money. We able to have a lot of opportunity, a lot of space. And the most important part of music to me personally, I know I'm being long-winded, but the most important thing about music to me is I had the ability to sit down and think. Before music, I was catching the bus here and walking here and doing this. I need some shells. I need this. I need blah. I'm getting into it with this person that I don't even know because I'm at the bus stop. The access to the, and now I got time to sit back and be like, I remember once Corey asked me like, man, what do you like? Like, what do you, then somebody asked me in an interview, what do you like? Like, what are you into? And I was like, I don't know, nothing. And then that was like, got to be an acceptance. So, you know, me, I was young. I looked at Corey. I'm like, Corey, like, because I had never had any time to have a hobby. I never had any time to like anything. You get what I'm saying? So it's like, we just got to be grateful for the opportunities. And like, to the people that, you know, running music, like, you know, just treat these people with humanity, man. Like, you worth something before you die.
Ladies and gentlemen, his name is Vince Staples. Really, really happy for you, man. Thank you. It's been entirely too long, and I'm excited to see you tonight at the Garden. I'm excited for the album coming out next month, Coachella, all that. Go check Vince Staples wherever you find music. Any final words, Vince?
Nah, man, I appreciate you. Thanks for the opportunity. For always, you know, same thing I tell y'all every time I see y'all, because I really mean it. Thank you for the opportunity, you know, just, you know, giving me a platform of years and years and years. I'm always come back. I appreciate you.
I appreciate you always coming back, bro. Vince Staples, ladies and gentlemen, hang tight.